The Benedict's test is widely used by a chemical assay for detecting the presence of reducing sugars in a sample. This qualitative test relies on Benedict's reagent, a blue solution containing kappa sulfate, which reacts with reducing sugars when heated. The reaction produces a color change, indicating the presence and approximate concentration of reducing sugars such as glucose and fructose. By observing the resulting color, ranging from green to red, one can determine the sugar content in various food samples. As I just said, Benedict's reaction is a chemical test used to detect the presence of reducing sugars. But what are reducing sugars? Reducing sugars are carbohydrates that act as reducing agents because they have free aldehyde or ketone groups, capable of reducing other substances. In chemistry, to get reduced means to gain electrons or to decrease the oxidation state of an element. Examples of monosaccharides that are reducing sugars include glucose, fructose, galactose, and ribose. Examples of disaccharides include lactose and maltose. Note that sucrose, commonly known as a table sugar, is not a reducing sugar, therefore it is not included in this list. Here is the structural formula of glucose. As you can see, it has an aldehyde group in its open chain form. Now here is the fructose, which has a ketone group in its open chain form. Both of these simple sugars are reducing sugars because glucose has aldehyde group and fructose has a ketone group. Many of the foods we eat contain these reducing sugars. But how can we detect them? How can we identify the presence of reducing sugars in our foods? Since there are reducing sugars, they can reduce certain chemicals. As I said, in chemistry, to be reduced means to gain electrons or to decrease oxidation state of an element or compound. Indeed, there is a chemical that can be reduced by these sugars, resulting in visible color change. The chemical is known as Benedict's reagent or Benedict's solution. When we add Benedict's solution to reducing sugars and heat the mixture, a chemical reaction occurs, leading to color change that indicates the presence of reducing sugars. Benedict's solution contains kappa ions. When it's mixed with the reducing sugars, kappa ions get reduced. In the Benedict's reaction, kappa ions of Benedict's reagent are reduced to kappa oxide, which precipitate out of solution, indicating the presence of reducing sugars. Again, in the Benedict's test for reducing sugars, when the reagent reacts with the sugar, a solid kappa oxide forms and separates from the liquid, creating a visible precipitate. This change helps us identify the presence of reducing sugars. Very often students ask me, what does to precipitate means? To precipitate means to cause a solid to form and separate out from a solution. Here is overall chemical reaction of the Benedict's test. In this reaction, the reducing sugar is oxidized, meaning loses electrons, and the kappa ions are reduced, meaning gain electrons, to form the kappa oxide precipitate. In this video, you will see me not using gloves and goggles during the Benedict's test. However, if you run the test yourself, I strongly recommend that you use gloves and goggles. Here is why. Benedict's reagent contains kappa sulfate, which can be harmful if it comes into contact with skin and eyes. Gloves and goggles help protect against potential irritation or chemical burns and are part of standard laboratory safety protocols. Now that we are clear on that, let me go over the procedure we will carry out today. First, we will need to obtain food samples, placing 2 milliliters in each test tube. We will do the same for our controls, using 2 milliliters each. I will explain the controls in a moment. Next, we will add Benedict's reagent, a blue solution, to each sample. Then we will place all the tubes in boiling water or water bath for about 5 minutes. Don't forget to wear gloves and goggles to protect yourself from burns. Even with gloves on, be careful when handling boiling water. After the water bath, we will examine the solutions for the presence of precipitates. The colors red, brown, yellow, and green indicates their presence. Here is the key to the whole test, so pay close attention. The extent of the color change from blue to green, yellow, orange, or red indicates the concentration of the reducing sugar. A small amount of reducing sugar will produce a green color. A moderate amount will produce a yellow color. A larger amount will result in an orange, red, or brown color. Thus, the presence of colored precipitate indicates that reducing sugars are present in the sample. The intensity of the color change corresponds to the amount of reducing sugar. Okay, now that we have covered the working principle of this test, let's proceed with the actual experiment. For this, we will obtain a test tube rack and 6 test tubes. Note that these tubes are special and have unique markings on them. They are not meant for us to write on. If you write on the white areas, it will be very hard to erase whatever you put there. The frosted markings indicate that laboratory glassware or test tubes are heat resistant. Using a glass marker, I wrote the numbers of our test tubes above the frosted area, not on it. Before we add the solutions to our test tubes, let's set some water to boil in a large beaker. Boiling water takes time, and you don't want to waste the time waiting for it. Therefore, we will place the beaker with the water on the hot plate in advance. Set the hot plate to the highest temperature so the water will boil quickly. Let's go back to our test tubes. In test tube number 1, we will put 2 milliliters of water. Why water? Why are we testing water for the presence of reducing sugars? We know that water has no sugars in it. It is H2O after all. The water will be our negative control, showing that the color of Benedict's solution will not change without the presence of reducing sugars even after heating. This is why we call it a negative control. It serves a baseline or standard for comparison to help ensure that the results of the experiment are valid. In test tube number 2, we will add 2 milliliters of glucose. Why are we testing glucose when we know it is a reducing sugar and will indeed change color? You're right, but this is our positive control. It ensures there is nothing wrong with our experiment. If the precipitate forms, the experiment is working correctly. If not, there is something wrong with the experiment. In the next 3 test tubes, we will add the same amount of tested food. In my case, I will put onion in test tube 3, apple juice in test tube 4, and egg albumin in test tube 5. In the test tube 6, I will add the unknown solution. At the end of the experiment, by comparing the colors, you will need to determine what the unknown solution is. Water, glucose, onion juice, apple juice, or egg albumin. So here all our test tubes filled with various solutions, controls, and food samples. Which of these foods will contain reducing sugars? What do you think? Let's find out. We have added 2 milliliters of Benedict's reagent to each of our controls and food samples. Initially, nothing happens. There is no visible changes. For the precipitate to form, we need to heat our solutions. Let's check if the water is boiling. If it is, we will place all our test tubes inside the beaker simultaneously. After 5 minutes, we need to carefully take our test tubes out of the beaker using a test tube holder. I have now taken the last test tube out of the beaker. Let's turn off the hot plate and remove the beaker using tongs. It is now time to examine the contents of our test tubes for the presence of reducing sugars. We want to ensure that we are examining the colors using a white background. Look at the contents of the test tubes against a white piece of paper. Using any other colored background could be misleading. Record your data in the data table and identify a known solution. Pause the video and take a close look at the screen to complete this step. Now let's see if you paid close attention to this video. If you did, it will not be difficult for you to answer the following question. What will happen if we test a solution of table sugar by mixing it with Benedict's solution? Will a precipitate form in the test tube with table sugar? This is for you to answer. In conclusion, the qualitative Benedict test is a valuable and straightforward method for determining the presence of reducing sugars in various samples. By observing the color change from blue to green, yellow, orange, or red upon heating, one can determine the presence and approximate amount of reducing sugars. This test is widely used in educational settings and research laboratories for its simplicity and effectiveness. Through this practical exercise, we have gained a better understanding of the chemical properties of reducing sugars and their reactivity with Benedict's reagent. The qualitative Benedict test remains a crucial tool in biochemistry for identifying and studying carbohydrate content in different substances. The Benedict test was developed by American chemist Stanley Benedict in 1909.